am discussing about the aminoglycosides. So aminoglycosides are the antibiotics which are used for the treatment of several diseases, mainly used in the chemotherapeutic as a chemotherapeutic agent. And the aminoglycosides, coming to the synthesis of the aminoglycosides, so it consists of the amine portion as well as the glycosidic portion. So the name which is the aminoglycosides is obtained by the or obtained from the amine portion combines with the glycosidic portion of the sugar moieties. So here what happens means this amine along with the sugar moiety, so come together, it forms the aminoglycosides. So this results in the synthesis or the production of the aminoglycosides. So mainly these aminoglycosides are obtained by the species, that is from the streptomyces, mainly from the streptomyces. So these aminoglycosides are mainly discovered in the year 1944 by the Waksman, by the scientist Waksman. And this aminoglycosides, the drugs are the bacteria, it has the bactericidal activities. So it mainly acts against the gram positive bacteria as well as the gram negative bacteria. Next, this aminoglycosides mainly act against the tuberculi bacilli. And the classification of the aminoglycosides are of two types, systemic aminoglycosides and the topical aminoglycosides. So whenever we are applying to the systemic route, they are classified as systemic aminoglycosides, and we are using it as a topical route, they are called as the topical aminoglycosides. So in this the systemic aminoglycoside examples are streptomycin, gentamicin, kanamycin and tobramycin are the some of the examples including in the systemic aminoglycosides. And coming to the topical aminoglycosides, neomycin and famacitin are the topical aminoglycosides. Next, spectrum of activity of aminoglycosides. Spectrum of activity of aminoglycosides. So when we are using this aminoglycoside as an antibiotic, it has a broad spectrum activity. So mainly it inhibits the bacterial cell wall. Mainly it inhibits the bacterial cell wall synthesis, and it acts against the gram positive bacteria and the gram negative bacteria. Mainly in the gram negative bacteria. Mainly it acts against the gram negative bacteria. So the gram negative bacteria mainly for tuberculi bacteria and tularemia. So mainly for the inhibition or act against the tuberculosis bacteria, mycobacterium tuberculi and tularemia bacteria. Okay, then coming next, mechanism of action. So main the aminoglycosides, it consists of the amine portion and the glycosidic portion, that is the sugar moiety. Whenever these aminoglycosides, it binds to the cell membrane. So it binds to the cell membrane. So in this mechanism of aminoglycosides, here we have two mechanism of actions. One is transport of aminoglycosides. The first mechanism of the aminoglycosides is the transportation of the aminoglycosides into the cell membrane. Another process is the binding to the ribosomes. So in these two mechanisms, these aminoglycosides have two mechanisms. One is the transport. First, initially the drugs or the aminoglycosidic drugs are transported into the cell membrane, so inside the cell membrane, and another one is binding to the ribosome. So whenever there is a transport of the aminoglycosides into the cells or into the cell membrane, so this transport of the drug, it depends upon the penetrability and cell permeability, penetrability and as well as the pore size. It depends upon the pore size. The transport of the aminoglycoside into the cells, it depends upon the pore size as well as the cell permeability and transporting invading mechanism. And second mechanism of the aminoglycoside is through binding to the ribosomes. So after entry of this drug into the cell membrane of the bacteria, it binds to the specific ribosomes. In particular, it binds to the 30S ribosomes. After binding of the aminoglycoside into the cell membrane, it binds to the 30S ribosomes in presence of. So here also, like that chloramphenicol, here also the acetyl amino acyl tRNA. Amino acyl tRNA. Here there is a peptide linkage formation. So in normal conditions, in the cell membrane, there is a formation of peptide chains. This peptide chain formation is due to the enzyme amino acyl tRNA. So this amino acyl tRNA binds to the 30S ribosomes and it forms a peptide chain. So whenever the drug enter into the cell, it directly binds to the 30S ribosomes and it degrades or it divides the binding capacity or attachment of the amino acyl tRNAs to the 30S ribosomes. In these conditions, what happens means there is an inhibition of the peptide chain formation, thus in turn inhibits the formation of the proteins from the 30S ribosomes. Not only the inhibition of the proteins from this 30S ribosomes, here there is a decrease in the initiation or the formation of the proteins from that 30S ribosomes, and there is a damage of the protein layer or the cell wall layers. Next, coming to the pharmacokinetics of the aminoglycosides. So this aminoglycosides has a poor oral absorption and it is mainly absorbed through the IV route or by the IM route. Next, almost nearly 1% of the drug, only 1% of the drug may be absorbed, and remaining 99% or above 95% of the drug may be excreted or eliminated through the urine by the kidneys. Next, resistance, development of the resistance. Here the aminoglycoside resistance can be by two mechanisms. So the same mechanism which is involved in the normal aminoglycosidic mechanism. So here the resistance is developed due to the decrease in the cell permeability of the cell membrane, or here there is a decrease in the attachment of the aminoglycosides to the ribosome. So these are the two mechanisms which are involved in the or to develop the resistance of aminoglycosides. Next, adverse effects are ototoxicity. By using of this aminoglycosides, mainly it disturbs or it affects our central nervous system and also to the external ears, mainly for the ear. So it leads to ototoxicity and nephrotoxicity and cochlear damages. So here we are seeing most of the drugs or most of the aminoglycosidic drugs mainly damages our internal ears, mainly at the vestibular and at the cochlear regions. And also another adverse effect by using this aminoglycoside is neuromuscular blockade. Okay, CNS activities in the CNS which causes the nephrotoxicity action and neuromuscular blockade actions, and also the ototoxicity and the cochlear damage and vestibular damages can be seen by using the aminoglycosides. And coming to this drug interactions, it can be interacted with the amphotericins, azithromycin and the cephalotin, and by using the loop diuretics. Its contraindications are, it can be contraindicated in the patients, pregnancy patients and lactation patients and renal impairment patients. Next, coming to the
start.
So coming to the streptomycin. So streptomycin is the systemic aminoglycoside. Comes under the classification of the systemic aminoglycoside. So this streptomycin was the first aminoglycoside antibiotic used as a chemotherapeutic agent. So it is obtained from the streptomycin greaseus. So it is actinomycetes. It is mainly obtained from the actinomycetes, that is from the streptomycin greaseus. So it has a broad spectrum. It acts as a broad spectrum of antibiotic. It acts against gram positive as well as the gram negative bacteria. Streptomycin has two actions. Next, adverse reactions of the streptomycin is vertigo, muscle pains, necrosis, skin rashes, and also joint pains can be seen by using the aminoglycoside, that is the streptomycin. And the mechanism of action of the streptomycin is also, it inhibits the bacterial cell wall synthesis after invading or after the transporting of the aminoglycoside, that is the streptomycin, whenever the streptomycin enter into the cell, it directly attaches to the 30S ribosomes and as well as the amino SLT RNase. Here there is a inhibition or there is a breakdown of the peptide chain formation by that streptomycin. And mainly the uses of the cell streptomycin is used in the TB, plague, endocarditis and in mainly in the E. coli infections. And it also can be contraindicated in the lactation, pregnancy patients and as well as the renal impairment patients. Next, coming to the next, kanamycin. So it is also a systemic aminoglycoside. After that, after the streptomycin, and it is used as a second antibacterial or anti-systemic aminoglycoside. It acts as a chemotherapeutic agent. So this kanamycin mainly obtained by the cultures from the Streptomyces canamycetes, and it has a broad spectrum of activity and mainly act against the gram-negative bacteria. Gram-negative bacteria mainly in the Salmonella typhi and Epsilla diseases or the infectious organisms. Next, adverse reactions of the kanamycins are related to the aminoglycosidic adverse reactions: nausea, vomiting, ototoxicity, nephrotoxicity, and cochlear and the vestibular toxicities. Next, coming to the uses of this kanamycin, it can be used as an mainly in the treatment of TB and acts as an antiseptic. Next, coming to the gentamicin.
Start.
So next is the gentamicin. Gentamicin is also a systemic aminoglycoside, and it is a third antibiotic, comes under the category of the systemic aminoglycoside. So after by using streptomycin and kanamycin, this is the third drug of the choice for the treatment of the tuberculosis diseases. Okay. So mainly it is obtained from the Monosporia purpurea. Cultures from the Micromonospora purpurea in the year 1964. So mainly it is used to treat the E. coli infections as well as the pneumonia conditions and Epsilla infectious diseases. Next, the use is mainly used in the tuberculosis patients. It acts against the Mycobacterium tuberculosis as well as the pneumonic conditions. Why this gentamicin is used regularly means it shows less toxic effects when compared to the streptomycin as well as the kanamycin, and also used to treat the eye infections, urinary tract infections and cochlear infections. Now coming to the drug interactions of the gentamicin, is it should not be used with the carbamazepine. Okay. Next, coming to this topical aminoglycosides. The topical aminoglycosides example is the neomycin. So neomycin is regularly used as a topical treatment. Okay. So this neomycin is mainly obtained from the soil bacteria, that is Streptomyces fradiae. Streptomyces fradiae, and is mainly by the scientist Waxman and the Lake Valier. Okay, by the scientist Waxman and the Lake Valier. And it mainly acts against the gram-negative bacteria, that is Staphylococcus aureus. So here the use of the neomycin is only to the topical administration. And the coming to the pharmacokinetics of the neomycin is it is easily penetrated, or it has a easy penetration power. So whenever we are applying to the topical route, it absorbs the cell membrane of the skin, absorbs the neomycin drug, and it enters into the cell wall, and it inhibits the mechanism of action of the neomycin is it also inhibits the bacterial cell wall synthesis as well as the protein synthesis by binding to the 30S ribosomes. And the adverse reactions of the neomycin is also shows that same effects, that is the cochlear damage and the vestibular damage, and mainly causes the vertigo. Okay. Next, this neomycin is used as a topical in the form of topical ointments to treat the ear as well as the skin infections or the in conditions of the dermatitis. Okay, so this is about the aminoglycosides. Aminoglycosides are classified into two types: systemic aminoglycosides and the topical aminoglycosides. Thank you so much.